Lady Chatterley's lover. Ours is essentially a tragic age, so we refuse to treat it tragically. We still have to live, no matter how many skies have fallen in. And this was, more or less, Constance Chatterley's position, for the war had brought the roof down over her head. She'd married Clifford Chatterley in 1917, when he was home for a month on leave. He was 29. Constance was then 23. He was shipped back to England again 6 months later, more or less in pieces. For 2 years he remained in doctor's hands, after which he was pronounced cured. He could return to life again, but with the lower half of his body from the hips down paralyzed forever. This was in 1920. Together they returned to his ancestral home, Ragby Hall, the family seat. Clifford was now a baronet. Constance was now Lady Chatterley. He was not really downcast, for he could wheel himself about in a wheelchair, or he could use a motorized bath chair. But he remained strange, almost bright and cheerful. Constance was a country girl, ruddy-looking with soft brown hair and a sturdy body, full of unusual energy. Ragby Hall was a long, low, old house in brownstone, which had been begun in the middle of the 18th century and added on to, until it had become a warren of a place without distinction. Its park overlooked Tevershall village, which, with its pit chimneys, started a trail of utterly hopeless ugliness for a long, gruesome mile. Houses, rows of wretched, small, begrimed brick houses with black slate roofs and sharp angles of willful, blank dreariness. With a stoicism characteristic of the young, Connie took in this soulless desolation of the coal and iron Midlands at a glance and left it at what it was, unbelievable and not to be thought about. Clifford professed to like Ragby Hall better than London. He liked this county, which had a grim will of its own, and its people who had guts. Connie wondered what else they had, certainly neither eyes nor minds. The people were as haggard, shapeless and dreary as the countryside, and just as unfriendly. There was no communication between Ragby Hall and Tevershall village, none. The colliers merely stared at them. The gulf was impassable, fueled by a quiet resentment on either side. Connie hardened herself to this steady drizzle of resentment, but it was not that she and Clifford were unpopular. They merely belonged to an entirely different species from the colliers. And yet the village sympathized with Clifford and Connie in the abstract. Clifford was extremely shy and self-conscious, now he was lame. He hated to see anyone other than their personal servants. He was rather supercilious and contemptuous of anyone not in his own class, standing his ground without any attempt at conciliation. Connie and he were attached to one another. He was a hurt thing, and as such, Connie stuck to him passionately. But she could not help feeling how little connection he really had with people. He was only remotely interested in the miners, like a man looking down a microscope or up into a telescope. He was not in touch. Even Connie felt that she herself didn't really, not really, touch him. Yet he was absolutely dependent on her. He needed her every moment. Big and strong as he was helpless. Alone, he was like a lost thing. He needed Connie to be there, to assure him he existed at all. She had to superintend the house, but it seemed to be run by mechanical anarchy. No warmth of feeling united it. The hall seemed as dreary as a disused street, so she left it alone. Connie and Clifford had spent nearly 2 years at Ragby Hall, living a vague life absorbed in Clifford and his writing. It was a life in a void. Although Ragby was there and the servants, it was spectral, as though it did not really exist. Connie went for walks in the park and woods and enjoyed their solitude and mystery. But it was all a dream. It had no substance for her. No touch, no contact. Only this endless life with Clifford. Time passed, but whatever happened, nothing happened. She was completely out of contact. She and Clifford lived through their ideas and his books. This, despite the fact she entertained continually, there were always people in the house. Connie was aware of her growing restlessness that twitched her limbs when she didn't want to twitch them. A mad restlessness that made her heart beat violently for no reason. And she was getting thinner. Vaguely, she knew she was moving away from reality. Her father advised her, "Why don't you get yourself a good man friend, Connie? Do you all the good in the world?" That winter, a young Irishman called Michaelis, who had made a rather large fortune in America from his plays, came to stay for a few days. He obviously wasn't an Englishman, in spite of all that the best tailors, hatters, barbers and cobblers of London had done. He desired to be where he didn't belong, among the English upper classes. And how they enjoyed the various jibes they aimed at him, and how he hated them. There was something about him that Connie liked. He didn't put on airs. He had no illusions about himself. "It's wonderful what you've achieved at your time of life," commented Clifford contemplatively. "And are you alone?" asked Connie. "How do you mean? Do I live alone?" "No, I've got my servant. I'm going to marry, for I must marry." "You make it sound like you're going to have your tonsils out," laughed Connie. "Will it be so much of an effort?" He looked at her admiringly. "Well, Lady Chatterley, somehow I feel it will. I know I can't marry an Englishwoman, so I've asked my man if he will find me a Turk or something." Connie wondered at this odd, somehow melancholy specimen of extraordinary success. She felt a sudden, strange leap of sympathy for him, mingled with such compassion, tinged with repulsion. But it almost amounted to love. Michaelis knew at once he'd made an impression on her. He knew just where he was with Clifford, but with his wife he was not quite so sure. The next morning, Michaelis was flattered by being asked up to Lady Chatterley's own sitting room. "It's very pleasant up here," he remarked as he went in. Connie and Michaelis sat on opposite sides of the fire and talked. She asked him about his relatives. Michaelis replied frankly, "Why are you such a lonely bird?" Connie asked him suddenly. He looked at her searchingly. "Some birds are made that way," he explained. "But look here, what about yourself? Aren't you something of a lonely bird yourself?" Connie, startled, thought about it for a few moments, and then she replied, "Only in a way, not altogether like you." "You're quite right," Michaelis responded. He looked up at her with a full glance that saw everything and registered everything. "May I hold your hand for a minute?" he asked suddenly, fixing his eyes on her. She stared at him, dazed and transfixed. He went over and knelt beside her and buried his face in her lap, remaining motionless. In all her burning embarrassment, she could not help putting her hand, with tenderness and compassion, on the nape of his neck. He trembled with a deep shudder. She was utterly incapable of resisting his appeal, giving him anything, everything. He was a curious and very gentle lover. To her, it meant nothing except that she gave herself to him. At length, he ceased to quiver any more and lay quite still. Then, with dim, compassionate fingers, she stroked his head that lay on her breast. When he rose, he kissed both her hands, then both her feet, and in silence moved away to the far end of the room. After some minutes, he turned and came back to her. "Now I suppose you'll hate me," he said quietly. "Why should I?" she asked. "A woman is supposed to." He paused. "Sir Clifford, won't he be..." "Perhaps," she said, looking up at him. "I don't want Clifford to know, not even to suspect. It would hurt him so much." He'll know nothing from me, he said almost fiercely. May I do anything for you? How can I be sure that you don't hate me, that you won't hate me? No, I don't hate you, she replied. I think you're nice. Ah, he responded. I'm glad you said that to me rather than said you love me. It means so much more. Until this afternoon, then. With that, he kissed her and was gone. That evening, Connie felt Michaelis must have forgotten their morning together. But he had not forgotten. He simply knew what he was, an outsider. He accepted this fact, and this isolation was a necessity to him, just as his appearance of conformity and of mixing with smart people were necessities. But occasional lovemaking, as a comfort, was also a good thing, and he was not ungrateful. He made love to her again on each of the 3 days he stayed. To Clifford, he was exactly the same as on the first evening, and to Connie also. There was no breaking down the external man. Connie never really understood him, but in her way, she loved him. So they went on for a while, writing and meeting occasionally in London, for she still wanted the physical and sexual thrill she could get from him, and he still wanted to give it to her. Then she was tremendously cheerful at Ragby. Yet when those days of joy and stimulus were gone, quite gone, she was once again depressed and irritable. Then how Clifford longed for them again. Had he known the cause, he might even have wished to get her and Michaelis together once more. At this time, Clifford was making great strides into fame and even money. People came to see him, though there were few men who visited regularly. But Connie found these friends of Clifford had such cold minds. She had more respect for Michaelis, on whom they poured scorn. In truth, Mitch, as she called him, was antisocial, which was what Clifford and his cronies had against him. They were more or less bent on saving mankind, or on instructing it to do as they said. On a frosty February morning, Clifford and Connie went for a walk across the park to the wood. That is, Clifford in his motor chair and Connie walking beside him. At the wood's edge, rabbits bobbed and nibbled. Rooks suddenly rose in a black train and went trailing off over the sky. In the wood itself, everything was motionless. Clifford loved the wood. He loved the old oak trees. He wanted to protect them. As he sat there, looking at the curve of the rise, he said, I consider this is really the heart of England. This is old England, and I intend to keep it intact. Oh, yes, said Connie. I want this wood perfect, untouched, Clifford went on. I want nobody to trespass in it. I'm more upset at not having a son when I come here than at any other time. But the wood is older than your family, noted Connie gently. Quite, agreed Clifford. But we've preserved it. If it wasn't for us, it would all go, like the rest of the forest. If it isn't preserved, there'll be no England left. That's why having a son helps. I'm only a link in a chain. I'm sorry we can't have a son, she said. He looked at her steadily. It would almost be a good thing if you had a child by another man, he remarked. If we brought it up at Ragby, it would belong to us and to the place. Did you think it's worth considering? Connie looked up. The child, her child, their child, was just an it to him. It, it, it. Clifford continued. Does it matter so very much? After all, you had that lover in Germany. What is he to you now? Almost nothing. What matters is what lasts through one's life. My own life matters to me, its long continuance and development. So what do these occasional sexual connections matter? You and I are married, no matter what happens to us. You and I are interwoven at marriage. If we stick to that, we ought to be able to arrange this sex thing, as if we were going to the dentist, since fate has given us a physical checkmate. Connie listened in a sort of wonder, mingled with a kind of fear. She did not know whether he was wrong or right. And wouldn't you mind what man's child I had? She asked. Why, Connie, I should trust your natural instinct of decency and selection. You just wouldn't let the wrong sort of fellow touch you. She thought of Michaelis. He was absolutely Clifford's idea of the wrong sort of fellow. I think you're right, Clifford, she said eventually. As far as I can see, I agree with you. Only life may put a new face on it all. But until life puts a new face on it, you agree? Oh, yes, I think I do, really. She was watching a brown spaniel that had run out of a side path. A man with a gun strode swiftly, softly after the dog. It was the new gamekeeper. But he had frightened Connie. He seemed to emerge with such swift menace. He was quickly going downhill. He was dressed in the old style. He had a red face and moustache and distant eyes. Mellors! Called Clifford. The man turned and saluted. Will you turn my chair round and get it started? Makes things easier, explained Clifford. The man came up. Connie, this is the new gamekeeper, Mellors. You haven't spoken to her ladyship yet, have you, Mellors? No, sir, came the ready, neutral words. Connie nodded her head shyly. But you've been here some time, haven't you? She asked.
8 months, madam, your ladyship.
Do you like it?
Why, yes, thank you, your ladyship. I was reared here.
They went on down the slope. As they reached the steepish rise of the knoll in the path, Connie looked up. The day had greyed over. There was a raw coldness in the air. It was going to snow. All grey. All grey. The world looked worn out. Once they reached the house, Mellors was dismissed. At lunch, Connie asked her husband, "Who is the gamekeeper?" "Mellors, you saw him," answered Clifford. "Yes, but where did he come from?"
"Nowhere. He was a Tevershall boy, son of a collier, I believe.
He was a keeper here before the war. I was very glad to get him back. He was married, but his wife went off with various men, but finally with a collier at Staxgate." "So this man's alone?"
"More or less. He has a mother in the village, and a child, I believe."
He stared at Connie in his peculiar way, giving her this precise information. It made him seem impersonal. She realized its source. Mentally, he was alert, but the paralysis, the lasting bruise of the aftershock, was gradually spreading to his affective self. It infected Connie with the fear of nothingness in her life. Michaelis came in the summer. His restlessness was evident. "Look here," he suddenly asked Connie, when they were at last alone in her sitting room. "Why don't you and I make a clean thing of it? Why don't we marry?" "But I am married," she replied, amazed. "Oh, that. He'll divorce you all right. Why don't you and I marry? I want to marry." "But I'm married already," she said. "I can't leave Clifford, you know." "Why not?" he cried. "He'll hardly know you've gone after 6 months. Why, the man's no use for you at all. He's entirely wrapped up in himself." Although Connie felt there was some truth in this, she also felt that Mitch was hardly making a display of selflessness. "I should have to think about it," she said. "I couldn't say now. It may seem to you Clifford doesn't count, but he does. When you think how disabled he is." "Damn it all. If a fellow's got nothing but his disabilities to recommend him..." He turned aside. Later that evening, he asked her, "You're coming to my room tonight, aren't you?" "All right," she answered. He was a more excited lover that night. He roused a certain craving passion in her, with his little boy nakedness and softness. Afterwards, he said, "All darned women are like that. Either they don't go off at all, as if they were dead in there, or else they wait till a chap's really done, and then they start in to bring themselves off, and a chap's got to hang on. I never yet had a woman who went off just at the same moment as I did." Connie was stunned by his incomprehensible brutality. It moved something in her. That night she almost loved him and wanted to marry him. Her whole sexual feeling for him, or for any man, collapsed that night. Her life fell apart from his completely, as if he'd never existed. She went through the days drearily, living a mean sort of life. On one of her bad days, she went out alone to walk in the wood. The report of a gun not far off startled and angered her. Then she heard voices and recoiled. People. She didn't want people. But her ear caught another sound. It was a child sobbing. Someone was ill-treating a child. Turning the corner, she saw the keeper and a little girl who was crying. "Oh, shut up, false little bitch," came the man's angry voice, and the child sobbed louder. Connie's eyes blazed. The man caught sight of her and saluted, but he was pale with anger. "What's the matter? Why is she crying?" demanded Connie. The man gave a little bow. "I cannot tell you, your ladyship," he replied. Connie turned to the child, a ruddy black-haired thing of 9 or 10. "What is it, dear? There, there, don't cry. See what I've got for you." She held out a sixpence. There were more sobs, but now subduing. "There, there, tell me what's the matter," asked Connie, as the child's hand closed over the coin.
It's the pussy," cried the girl. "There."
Connie looked to where there was a big black cat stretched out grimly.
"A poacher, your ladyship," said the man.
She glanced at him angrily. "No wonder the child cried if you shot it when she was there." She turned back to the child. "What's your name?" she asked.
"Connie Mellors,"
responded the piping voice. "Connie Mellors, that's a nice name. And did you come out with your daddy and he shot the pussy? But it was a bad pussy." The little girl looked at her.
"I wanted to stop with my gran," she said, pointing down the drive. "At cottage."
"At the cottage? And would you like to go back to her?"
"Yes."
"Then shall I take you?" She turned to the man. "This is your little girl, isn't it?" he saluted. "I suppose I can take her to the cottage," asked Connie.
"If your ladyship wishes."
"Good morning," said Connie to him, as she walked on with the child. Before long, the girl was left with her gran, and Lady Chatterley went slowly home to Ragby Hall to join forces again with Clifford to complete one of his stories. She'd made up her mind that she wanted only a child, a baby. That was still one sensation left for her. She would venture very gingerly on that experiment. There was still the man to consider, and curiously, there wasn't a man in the world whose children she wanted. She had an idea that he would have to be a foreigner, not an Englishman, still less an Irishman, a real foreigner. Next winter, she would get Clifford to London. The following winter, she would move him abroad to the south of France or Italy. Connie went out alone every day now, mostly to the wood. Nobody saw her there. One day, Clifford wanted to send a message to the keeper, and as the boy was laid up with flu, Connie said she would make the call instead. As she came out of the wood, she saw the keeper's brown stone cottage. At first, it looked uninhabited. It was so silent and alone. But a thread of smoke rose from the chimney, and the little garden was dug and kept very tidily. The door was shut. She knocked. There was no answer, so she went round the back and stopped. In the little yard, the man, half-naked, was washing himself, utterly unaware of her presence. Connie backed away round the corner of the house and hurried away to the wood. In spite of herself, she'd had a shock. But in her confusion, she was determined to deliver the message to the fellow. She would not be balked. So she sauntered slowly back, listening. The cottage looked just the same. A dog barked, and she knocked again. She heard the man coming lightly downstairs. He opened the door quickly and startled her.
"Lady Chatterley," he said. "Will you come in?"
She stepped into the rather dreary little room. "I only called with a message from Sir Clifford," she said softly. His eyes looked warm and kind, wonderfully alive and at ease. "Do you live here alone?" she asked.
"Quite alone, your ladyship."
"But your mother?" she asked.
"She lives in her own cottage in the village with the child. She comes and cleans for me on Saturdays. I do the rest myself."
Connie wondered at him. She wanted to say so many things, and yet she said nothing. Her only remark was, "I hope I didn't disturb you."
"Only combing the air. Nobody knocks here, and the unexpected always sounds ominous."
He went out to the garden path with her after she'd given her message. She wandered back into the wood, not knowing that this man of 37 was looking after her, and went indoors thinking, "She's nice, she's real. She's nicer than she knows." Afterwards, Connie wondered much about him. He seemed so unlike a gamekeeper. He was something out of the ordinary. That evening when she went to bed, she sobbed bitterly. And in her bitterness burned a cold indignation against Clifford and his writings and his talk, against all the men of his sort who defrauded a woman even of her own body.
Unjust. Unjust.
A sense of deep physical injustice burned her to her very soul. But in the morning, she was up at 7 as usual and going downstairs to Clifford. She had to help him in all the intimate things, for he had no man and had refused a woman servant. It was a demand on Connie, but she'd wanted to do what she could, so she hardly ever left Ragby Hall, and never for more than a day or two, when Mrs. Betts, the housekeeper, attended to Clifford, who took the service for granted. A sense of rebellion smouldered in Connie that morning.
What was the good of it all?
What was the good of her sacrificing, her devoting her life to Clifford? What was she serving, after all? A cold spirit of vanity craving for success. When all the visitors came and went, it was no better. She continued plodding on, but a sense of exasperation and irritation had seized her, which she couldn't escape. The days seemed to grind by, nothing happened. She was getting thinner. Even the housekeeper noticed it and asked her about herself. Connie needed help and knew it. So she wrote a little cri de coeur to her sister Hilda. I've not been well lately, and I don't know what's the matter with me. So down came Hilda from Scotland that March.
Connie, she cried on arrival, whatever's the matter with you?
Nothing, said Connie rather shamefacedly.
But you're ill, child, said Hilda looking at her.
No, not ill. Perhaps I'm just bored, replied Connie. The light of battle glowed in Hilda's face. This wretched place, she murmured, looking at lumbering Ragby Hall with real distaste. Soft and warm, as a ripe pear herself, Hilda was an Amazon of the old breed, she went on quietly to Clifford. He thought how handsome she looked, but also he shrank from her. He considered his wife's family as outsiders, while he sat well-groomed, his well-bred expression inscrutable. Hilda thought he looked sulky and stupid.
Connie's looking awfully unwell, she declared in her soft voice.
She's a little thinner, he replied.
Haven't you done anything about it?
Do you think it necessary, he asked. Hilda glowered at him.
I'll take her to a doctor, she said, in London, one whom I trust.
Though boiling with rage at her impertinence, Clifford said nothing. Over coffee after dinner, Hilda once again addressed Clifford.
You must have a nurse or somebody to look after you personally. It's necessary. Either that or Father and I must take Connie away for some months. This can't go on.
What can't go on? Clifford asked.
Haven't you even looked at the child? Asked Hilda.
Connie and I will discuss it, he replied.
I've already discussed it with her, stated Hilda.
Clifford had been long enough in the hands of nurses. He hated them, because they left him no real privacy, and he couldn't stand a man hanging around him. Much better any woman, so why not Connie? On examination in London, the doctor recommended Connie had to be amused.
You're spending your life without renewing it, he continued. You can't go on, you know. Depression. Avoid depression.
On their return to Ragby, Hilda spoke to Clifford. Here is the address of a good man servant. I can assure you he really is a good man and sure to come.
But I'm not an invalid, and I'll not have a man servant, objected Clifford.
Very well, then. If we don't settle something by tomorrow, I shall telegraph Father, and together we shall take Connie away.
Will Connie go? Asked Clifford.
She doesn't want to, but she knows she must. We're not running any more risks. So next day, Clifford suggested Mrs. Bolton, the Tevershall parish nurse, as his helper. The two sisters called on Mrs. Bolton at once. She would come to Ragby immediately, if Dr. Shardley would let her off. So on the following Sunday, Mrs. Bolton duly arrived at Ragby Hall with her two trunks. Hilda talked things over with her, and Mrs. Bolton was ready at any moment to chat. Although she seemed so young, from the way passion would flush in her rather pale cheeks, she was in fact 47. Her husband, Ted Bolton, had been killed in the pit 22 years before, leaving her alone with two children to bring up. The upper classes fascinated her, appealing to her peculiar English passion for superiority. She was thrilled to come to Ragby, thrilled to talk to Lady Chatterley. Yet one could also notice a grudge against the Chatterleys in her, a grudge against the masters. For the first week or so, Mrs. Bolton was very quiet at Ragby. Her assured, bossy manner left her. She seemed nervous. With Clifford, she was shy, almost frightened and silent. He liked that, and soon recovered his self-possession, letting her do things for him without even noticing her. "She's a useful non-entity," he declared. Connie opened her eyes in wonder, but she did not contradict him. In time, he bullied the nurse, but she didn't mind. She neither resented nor disliked Clifford. Now quietly, subtly, Connie was unravelling the tangle of Clifford's consciousness and hers, breaking the threads gently, one by one. With both patience and impatience, she struggled to get clear. But the bonds of love are more difficult to loose than most bonds, though Mrs. Bolton's arrival had been a great help. Clifford still wanted the old intimate evenings of talk with Connie, talk or reading aloud. But now, at 10, Connie would go upstairs and be alone, believing Clifford was in good hands with Mrs. Bolton. Connie felt herself released into another world. She felt she breathed differently. But she was still afraid of how many of her roots were tangled with Clifford's. Yet still she seemed free. A new phase was beginning in her life. Mrs. Bolton also kept a caring eye on Connie, feeling she must extend to her her female and professional protection. She was always urging her ladyship to be in the open air, for Connie had got into the habit of sitting still by the fire, pretending to read or sew, and hardly going out at all. One blustery day, soon after Hilda had gone, Mrs. Bolton suggested to Connie, "Now, why don't you go for a walk through the wood and look at the daffodils behind the keeper's cottage? They're the prettiest sight. You could bring some back to put in your room." Connie took all this in good part. Little gusts of sunshine blew, strangely bright, lit up the celandines at the wood's edge. They spangled bright and yellow. Connie was strangely excited in the wood, and the colour flew back to her cheeks and burned blue in her eyes. She drifted on until she came to the clearing and saw the green moss-stained stone cottage, now looking almost rosy, the stone warmed in a burst of sunlight. The door was closed. No sound was to be heard, no smoke from the chimney, no dog barking. She went quietly round the back. She had an excuse to see the daffodils. And there they were, rustling, fluttering and shimmering, so bright and alive, with nowhere to hide their faces from the wind. Constance sat down and watched the daffodils turn golden in a sudden bright ray of sun that warmed her hands and her lap. The sunshine quickly gave way to chill. The daffodils were once more in shadow. She rose, took a few daffodils and went back to the hall. She had hated breaking the flowers. The next afternoon she went to the wood again, this time to follow a spring called Blinn's Well. How icy and clear it was, how brilliant. She listened to the faint tinkle of water as the tiny overflow trickled downhill. The place was a little sinister, cold and damp. As Connie rose to go home, she heard a faint tapping away to her right, and she stood still to listen. It was hammering. She walked on, turning down a new track between fir trees, which she followed while all the time the sound of the hammering grew nearer. She saw a secret little clearing, and a secret little hut made of poles. She realized it was the quiet place where growing pheasants were reared. The keeper was in his shirt sleeves, kneeling, hammering. The dog trotted forward to meet her with a short, sharp bark, and the keeper lifted his face suddenly and saw her, with a startled look in his eyes. He resented the intrusion. "I wondered what the hammering was," she explained, feeling a little afraid of him. "I'm getting the coops ready for June birds," he replied. "I should like to sit down for a while," she said. He went into the hut and drew out a chair. He looked at her hands, they were rather blue, so he took some larch twigs and lit a fire. "Sit here a bit and warm you," he ordered. She obeyed him. She did not really want to sit, cramped up in a corner by the fire. She would rather have watched from the door, but she was being looked after, so she had to submit. She listened to the tapping of the man's hammer. It was not so happy. She sensed he felt oppressed, that she was a trespasser on his privacy and a dangerous one. A woman. He did not want to come into contact with a woman again. He feared it, for he had a big, unhealed wound from old contacts. He felt if he could not be alone, if he could not be left alone, he would die. His last refuge was this wood. Connie grew warm by the fire. Then she grew hot. She went and sat on the stool in the doorway, watching the man at work. He seemed to take no notice of her, but he knew all right. He finished off the coop, while Connie watched him fixedly. She felt his experience had been deeper and wider than her own. Much deeper and wider, and perhaps more deadly. Mellors wished above all else that she would go away and leave him to his privacy. He dreaded her cool, upper-class impudence, her having her own way. For after all, he was only a hired hand. He disliked her presence there. Connie came to herself suddenly. She rose. The afternoon was turning to evening, yet she could not go away. She went over to the man. "It's so nice here, so restful," she said. "I think I shall come and sit here sometimes."
"Yes?"
"Do you lock up the hut when you're not here?"
"Yes, your ladyship."
"Do you think I could have a key too, so that I could sit here sometimes?"
"That Mr. Clifford'd know," he said, trying to put her off.
"Very well, I'll see to it."
"All right, your ladyship."
Their eyes met. His showed a cold, ugly look of dislike and contempt for her, mixed with indifference to what would happen. Hers were hot with rejection. Her heart sank as she understood how utterly he disliked her when she went against him. "Good afternoon," she said finally.
"Afternoon, m'lady."
He saluted and turned away. She walked sullenly home. Back at Ragby, as she poured Clifford his tea, she asked him, "Do you think there's a second key to that little hut not far from John's Well, where the pheasants are reared?"
"There may be. Why?"
"I happened to find it today. It's a lovely place. I could sit there sometimes, couldn't I?"
"Was Mellors there?"
"Yes, that's how I found it, from his hammering. He didn't seem to like my intruding at all. In fact, he was almost rude when I asked him about a second key. He said he knew nothing about keys."
"There may be one in Father's study. Betts knows them all. I'll get him to look."
"Oh, do," she said. "I didn't see why Mellors should mind. It's not his home, after all. I didn't see why I shouldn't sit there if I want to."
"Quite," said Clifford. "He thinks too much of himself, that man. But he does his duty all right, as far as I'm concerned."